Awesome. Well, let's get started. So hi, everyone. Welcome to an Indistractable Hour with award-winning author Nir Eyal. As everyone's joining, I'm just going to get started with a short introduction. I am Casey, part of the marketing team here at Clockwise, and I'm so excited to introduce you, our speaker for the next 30 to 40 minutes, Nir Eyal. So Nir writes, consults, teaches about the intersection of psychology, technology, and business. He is the author of two best-selling books, Hooked, How to Build Habit-Forming Products, and Indistractable, How to Control Your Attention and Choose Your Life. So today he's going to be diving into the root causes of distraction and will supply us with practical advice on how to stay productive and sane in an age of ever-increasing demands on our attention. So much of what Nir has to share today connects with what we fundamentally believe at Clockwise about what it takes to do your best work. So we are really thrilled to have the opportunity to have Nir with us today. A few housekeeping items before we get started. So we're going to use the Q&A feature at the bottom of Zoom webinar instead of chat, keeping in mind the theme of our talk today. So if you have any questions that come up, feel free to pop them into the Q&A feature and take some time right now to find where that's at. And then at the end of Nir's chat, we will go ahead and tackle your questions. So there should be lots for us to review at the end. And of course, this event will be recorded and we will share out the recording within 24 hours after the event wraps up. And with that, over to you, Nir.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. Thank you, Clockwise, for hosting. It's wonderful to be with you. Thanks for everyone for attending. So my Indistractable journey began after I wrote my first book, Hooked, which was all about how to build habit-forming products. And the book has been used in every conceivable industry to build habits for good. So what I basically did with this book was to steal the secrets of the world's most engaging habit-forming companies. Think about Facebook and Twitter and WhatsApp and Slack and Snapchat, and distill down what makes those products so habit-forming so that the rest of us who are building the kind of products and services that can really improve people's lives can use those tactics for good. So companies like Kahoot in the edtech space get kids hooked onto online learning. Companies like Fitbod in the healthcare space get people hooked to exercise. Those are just a few examples of companies that have used this methodology to build healthy habits in users' lives, to get them hooked to healthy habits. But there's another side to the story, that sometimes when we build products that are so engaging, that are so good at changing our habits and behaviors, sometimes some of these products can become distractions. And so I had to consider my own relationship with distraction. When I was with my own daughter one afternoon, we were sitting together, we had this beautiful day planned and just some quality daddy-daughter time. And I remember we had this book of activities that dads and daughters could do together. And there's all kinds of things in the book, like play a Sudoku puzzle or have a paper airplane contest, all kinds of little games and things. But I remember there was also this activity that I'll never forget. And that activity was to ask each other, if you could have any superpower, what superpower would you want? And I remember that question verbatim, but I can't tell you what my daughter said, because in that moment, for whatever reason, I thought it was a good time to just check this one really important thing I had to do right now. And by the time I looked up from my device, she was gone, because I was sending her a very clear message that whatever was on my phone was more important than she was. And she decided to go play with some toy in another room. And so that's when I really knew I had to reassess my own relationship with distraction. And if I'm honest with you folks, it didn't just happen with my daughter. It would happen when I would say, oh, today is going to be the day that I exercise. Today, I'm going to start eating right. Today, I'm going to work on that big project. I'm not going to procrastinate. I'm not going to delay. I'm not going to get distracted. And yet I didn't, and I wouldn't. And you see, this is why distraction is the fundamental struggle of our time. Because today, for the first time in history, we all know what to do. Who doesn't know how to eat healthily, right? If you don't know, Google it. It's all out there. Who doesn't know how to exercise? Again, if you don't know, there's a book about it. There's hundreds of books about it. Google it. You can find the answer. Who doesn't know if you want to have a better relationship with your family and friends, you have to be fully present with them? Who doesn't know that if you want to be better at your job, you have to do the hard work that other people don't want to do? The problem is no longer that we don't know how to do. the things that we need to do. It's that we don't know how to get out of our own way. We don't know how to stop being distracted. And so being indistractable is the skill of the century. There is no area of your life that doesn't depend upon your ability to focus your time and attention, your mental health, your physical health, your relationships, your career. You cannot be your best in any of these areas if you do not control your attention. And so what I want to offer up is a new way of thinking about distraction to get to the root cause of distraction so that we can finally all become indistractable. Starting with an understanding, this is not a new problem. My knee-jerk reaction, as I think most people's are these days, is that this is technology's fault, right? If it wasn't for these gadgets, if it wasn't for these devices, if it wasn't for this attention economy hijacking our brain, then we'd all be focused and super productive. Of course, that's nonsense. Because we know that since time immemorial, people have been struggling with distraction. In fact, the Greek playwright Plato, the philosopher Plato, talked about akrasia, the tendency to do things against our better interest. And so if people as far back as 2,500 years ago, Plato was talking about how distracting the world is these days, the root cause of the problem cannot be our technology. There has to be a deeper reason why we don't do the very things we know we need to do. Has it gotten more challenging? Has it become more difficult? Probably, yes. But of course, the price of all these gadgets, the price of all these amazing tech devices that we have that connect us to each other and the world's information right in the palm of our hand, is that we need to learn some new tactics, some new norms, some new ways of being in the world in order to get the best out of these devices without letting them get the best of us. And so what I want to offer you is a new way, a new tech positive way to look at the problem of distraction, starting with understanding what is distraction really. If you ask most people, what is the opposite of distraction? They'll tell you the opposite of distraction is focus. But that's not exactly right. You see, if you look at the origin of the word distraction, it actually shares a common root with its opposite, distraction, right? Traction and distraction, they both have the same common Latin root, trahare, which means to pull. And you'll see that both words end in the same six letters, A-C-T-I-O-N, which spells action. So traction is the opposite of distraction. Focus is what you do with your attention. But the opposite of distraction is traction, traction and distraction. Now, there's some common myths about distraction and traction that we should address. One is that we can moralize and medicalize what people do with their time. That you playing video games, that's somehow morally reprehensible. But me watching football on TV, that's okay. I say no. Anything you want to do with your time and attention, anything that you decide in advance is worthy of your precious time on earth, as long as it is done with forethought, do it. I'm not going to be the person that says, don't go on Facebook, don't check email, don't do whatever. You know, whatever it is you want to do with your time, you want to play Pokemon or whatever it is you want to do, I'm not going to tell you what you do want to do with your time. What I want to do is to help you do what you yourself want to do with your time and attention. Anything you plan to do in advance with forethought, that's traction, okay? Conversely, anything that is not that is distraction. And let me just identify here that what we know when we do these studies of how people spend their time and later regret how they spent their time, where they get distracted, it's not the things you would expect. You know, the things that you expect, you know, the video games or social media or Netflix, those are not actually the biggest sources of distraction. What we find is actually some of the biggest sources of distraction are the things that we don't really account for. Let me give you a great example. For years, I would get into work and I would sit down at my desk. And I would say, oh, you know, here's my mile-long to-do list. Here's all the things I have to get done. And we'll talk about later in the presentation why to-do lists can be one of the worst things you do for your productivity. We'll get this back to this in a minute. But I would say, okay, here's that big project, the number one thing on my list. I got to do that. I'm going to do that first. Nothing's going to get in my way. I'm not going to get distracted. Here I go. I'm going to get started right now. But first, let me just check some email, right? Has that happened to anybody? Where you say, let me just do that. Let me just check the Slack channel real quick, just to get caught up on what's going on within the office. And what you don't realize is that that is in fact the biggest source of distraction. Why? Because we don't realize that distraction has tricked us into prioritizing the urgent and the easy tasks at the expense of the hard and important work we have to do to move our lives and careers forward. So the important takeaway here is, just because something is a work-related task doesn't mean it's not a distraction. If you said you were going to work on that big presentation, you were going to do that big project, but then you didn't, you checked email, you did something else instead of doing the thing you said you were going to do ahead of time, it is just as much of a distraction as going on social media and playing a video game. So the difference between traction and distraction is one word, and that word is forethought, the intent of planning your time in advance. So now that we've defined what is traction and what is distraction, we have to talk about the triggers, what prompts us to take these actions, which can lead us towards traction or distraction. The first is, you'll be very familiar with, these are called external triggers. And this is what most people blame when they think about distraction. They blame the pings, the dings, the rings, anything in our outside environment that tells us what to do next and can lead us to traction or distraction. Now, even though that is a source of distraction, it turns out that all the pings, dings, and rings account for only 10% of the time we get distracted. 10%. So what's the other 90%? The other 90% of the time that we get distracted, it turns out it's not about what's happening outside of us, but rather what I learned in my 5 years of research working on this book is that most distractions, 90% of our distraction study found, they begin from within. It's called an internal trigger. An internal trigger is an uncomfortable emotional state that we seek to escape. And this is where we have to start on our journey to becoming indistractable. Because again, 90% of the time that we get distracted, it's because of a feeling that we don't know what to do with in a productive manner. Boredom, loneliness, fatigue, stress, anxiety, uncertainty. These are the internal triggers that if we are not prepared to deal with them in a healthy fashion, will lead us towards distraction. So listen carefully, folks. I don't care if it's too much food, too much booze, too much news, too much football, too much Facebook. If you are not prepared to deal with these uncomfortable emotional triggers, you will always get distracted by something. So the first step to becoming indistractable is to understand what is that discomfort that you are trying to escape. And then once we identify that discomfort, we only have two potential solutions. We can either fix the source of that discomfort, right? Change the job if we're working in a toxic workplace environment, figure out our circumstances to correct whatever is causing us emotional, a lack of emotional well-being. But sometimes you can't fix every problem, right? Part of being a grown-up is dealing with discomfort. And so not every discomfort needs to be escaped. It's not always a solution to drink to relax or to escape to relax or to scroll to relax. We need to oftentimes learn to deal with these uncomfortable sensations in a way that serves us as opposed to hurts us. So how can we do that? We need to first acknowledge that time management is pain management. Let me say that again. Time management is pain management. I would also add that money management is pain management. Weight management is pain management. Why? Because all human behavior, everything you do, every human behavior is spurred by a desire to escape discomfort. Let me say that again. Every human behavior is spurred by a desire to escape discomfort. Even the desire to feel good, wanting, craving, lusting, all these things, these are psychologically destabilizing. So once you understand that all human behavior is spurred by a desire to escape discomfort, then all action is about managing that discomfort. And this is an age-old concept. This is essentially what Buddhism teaches us, right? That life is about suffering, not in an awful nihilistic way, but more in terms of if we are battling against our impulses, our impulse to eat that chocolate cake if we're trying to watch our weight, our impulse to smoke that cigarette, our impulse to scroll and get distracted doing something we know we'll later regret. It is fundamentally about pain management. So what do we do about this pain management? Well, we're not going to have time to cover every technique that we can apply, but I want to give you some very concrete techniques that you can use right away. Of course, there's dozens more in the book, so I encourage you to check that out. But I want to give you just a few very helpful techniques, starting with noting the sensation. If you can bring awareness to what is that sensation that you are feeling before the distraction, no matter what that distraction is, what are you feeling before that distraction? If you can just note it down, that's a huge first step to on your path to becoming indistractable. Then get curious about that sensation, not contemptuous. You see, most people tend to fall into two kinds of buckets when it comes to distraction. We have what we call the blamers and the shamers. The blamers, they blame things outside themselves. Oh, it's my cell phone. Oh, it's my kids distracting me. It's my boss. It's Facebook. It's this and this. All these things outside of me are distracting me. And of course, being a blamer is kind of futile because these things will always exist. You're not going to rewind the clock. You're not going to hop into a time machine and go back to a time without distraction because distraction has always been with us. So being a blamer is fruitless. Being a shamer is also futile. So a shamer, this is the kind of person who takes it on the inside. They don't blame things outside themselves. They shame themselves. And you hear people saying this when they diagnose themselves with something that they've never actually seen a clinician. Oh, I must have ADHD. Yes, some people do have ADHD. It's about 3% of the population, which means that unless you've gone to a physician and gotten a diagnosis, 97% chance you don't have ADHD. But of course, if we blame ourselves, if we shame ourselves, if we say, oh, I have a short attention span, I'm no good with time management, I'm not a morning person, I'm a Sagittarius, we start bucketing ourselves into an identity, which of course, as we all know, as Henry Ford famously said, whether you believe you can or you can't, you're right. So don't be a blamer, don't be a shamer, be a claimer. A claimer claims responsibility, not for how they feel. This is a really important point. You do not control your feelings. This is a newsflash for a lot of folks. Did you know you do not control your feelings? All you can control is how you will respond to those feelings, hence the term responsibility. Think about it like a sneeze, okay? If you feel the urge to sneeze, do you control the urge to sneeze? No, you already felt it. What you do is control how you will respond to that urge. Will you take out a handkerchief and cover your face, which is the responsible thing to do? Or are you gonna sneeze all over everyone and get them sick? Right? So what you want to do is to become a claimer. You will claim responsibility over what you will do in response to those uncomfortable emotional triggers. Will you escape them with distraction, or will you use them like rocket fuel to propel you towards traction? Once you get curious about that sensation, what you can do now is to surf the urge. Surfing the urge is a wonderful technique. It comes to us from acceptance and commitment therapy, and it acknowledges that these uncomfortable internal triggers, these negative emotions, they're like waves. They crest and then they subside. And your job is to surf the urge like a surfer on a surfboard. How do you do that? Well, one technique that I use almost every single day is called the 10-minute rule. The 10-minute rule says that you can get back to that distraction. You can give in to anything that might distract you, whether it's smoking the cigarette if you're trying to quit, whether it's eating the chocolate cake if you're on a diet, whether it's checking the news if you're trying to get work done, checking email if you're on a big project, whatever the case might be. You can do it. You're allowed. You're a grown adult. You can do whatever you want, but not right now. You can do it in 10 minutes. So, you know, I write every single day. I've been a professional author now for over a decade, and writing is really hard. It never becomes easy. And so every day while I'm writing and I have all these doubts, these triggers, these uncomfortable emotions, this is hard, this is boring, is anybody gonna like what I'm writing? What I say to myself is before I get that itch to go check email or go check the news or go do anything but, I say, okay, I can do those things, but not right now. So I set a timer for 10 minutes and now I have a choice to make. There's a crossroads. I can either get back to the task at hand or surf the urge. Sit with that sensation for just a few minutes. And I teach you in the book how to have a self-talk session with yourself just for a few seconds to figure out what's going on. What's the source of that sensation? And by identifying what's happening and inferring that sensation as something positive, as something that is making you better as opposed to something you need to escape, this is how we train our brains to become indistractable. And if you still have that urge, if you still want to give in, no problem. You can at the end of the 10 minutes. But here's the kicker. 9 times out of 10, by the time that timer goes off, you're back in flow, you're back doing the work you need to do, and you don't even need to go back to that distraction in the first place. So try this 10-minute rule. For a lot of people, it's a real game changer, and it's just one of dozens of techniques that I described in the book, Indistractable. The next step of the Indistractable model is traction. It's making sure that we know what it is we want to do with our time. So one of the things I see all the time with people who are struggling with distraction is when they tell me, oh my goodness, my life is so, I'm so distracted. You know, my boss wants this and my kids want that. And did you see what happened on Twitter? One of my first questions is, what did you get distracted from? Show me your schedule, show me your calendar. And oftentimes it's blank, right? Maybe they have a mile long to-do list, but they have nothing on their calendar. And so of course my response is you can't call something a distraction unless you know what it is distracting you from. Let me say that again. You cannot call something a distraction unless you know what it is distracting you from. So unless you are a child or a retiree, you have to plan your day, which is, of course, why I'm so proud to be here with Clockwise, is you've got to plan your time or somebody else will plan it for you. The days of having an open schedule and just letting whatever happen, happen, if that's working for you, great, stick with it. But for the vast majority of people, the people who are struggling and saying, look, I know I am capable of more. I am not my best. I'm not exercising when I say I will. I'm not fully present with my colleagues, with my kids. I'm not doing my best work because I feel like I'm doing 100 things at once and I'm not able to work without distraction. If you do not plan your day, somebody will plan it for you. You have got to keep a time box calendar or this problem will continue to come up. Because again, if you don't know what you got distracted from, how do you know you got distracted at all? Everything is a distraction. Unless you know what is a distraction and what is traction and everything else is a distraction. So we have to make time for traction by planning the time, not the output. And this is why to-do lists are potentially so bad for people's productivity. To-do list is one of the worst things that most people do because they do it wrong. Keeping a list of things that you need to get done, that's fine. Getting it out of your brain and putting it into an app or on a piece of paper, great. But people forget the critical next step, which is to put it on your schedule. Why? Because a to-do list is limitless. There's no constraints. You can add more and more and more and more things to a to-do list. And so what happens? You get home from work, it's been a hard day. You feel like you've worked really, really, you were busy all day. You're completely spent. And then you look at your to-do list and you still have 100 things you haven't accomplished. And so what does that do to your psyche when day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, you're looking at all these promises you didn't keep to yourself, loser. And so you're reinforcing the self-image of someone who doesn't do what they say they're going to do. And so this is why after years of this nonsense, people say, well, I must be broken. I must be somehow deficient. No, you're not deficient. You're not broken. The technique you're using is deficient and broken. So what do you do instead of just planning the output, which is just this list of things you want to do, plan the input. Well, for knowledge workers, what is our input? It's just two things. Our input is our time and our attention. That's it. And so that's why we've got to use a much better technique of time boxing our day rather than just using the to-do list technique. So what I do is in my calendar, if I have a bunch of little tasks, you know, a bunch of admin stuff, I'll still do that, but in a time box in my schedule. A very, very important technique. The next thing you want to do is to make sure you spend less time communicating and more time concentrating. We know that all these pings, dings, and rings that we experience in the modern American workplace, whether you're working from home, whether you're working in the office, so many of these come from other people. And so we want to make sure that we have that time in our schedule, for example, to check email, right? Don't check email whenever an email comes in. Don't sit in Slack all day long checking what comes in. Make sure you have that time booked in your calendar. And we can talk about a little later in the Q&A, how do you socialize that? What do you do if your boss expects you to always be available, but that's causing you to have a very poor work output because you're constantly on edge, you're constantly distracted? Well, there's a lot you can do with that. Part of the reason that these pings and dings that we just talked about are so distracting is that they come in the form of these external triggers, right? These pings, dings, and rings in our environment, even though it's only 10% of the source of distraction, they can lead to us getting off track. Well, there's one profession that relies upon there's one profession where distraction is literally a matter of life and death. If I were to ask you, what is the third leading cause of death pre-corona, okay, pre-COVID, the third leading cause of death in the United States of America, what would you guess it would be? Maybe Alzheimer's, not even close. Drunk driving, not even in the same ballpark. I'll give you a hint. The number one cause of death in the United States of America is heart disease. Number two is cancer. If it was a disease, the third leading cause of death in the United States of America would be prescription mistakes. Prescription mistakes. People given the wrong medication or the wrong dosage of medication from healthcare practitioners in hospital settings. Okay. Now, most hospitals in America say, well, what do you want from us, right? It's a human error. It happens, right? It's the cost of doing business. We're sorry. Until a brave group of nurses at UCSF wanted to figure out what was going on. And what they understood from an extensive study that they did, that this problem of 200,000 Americans every year having potentially lethal consequences from getting the wrong medication, the wrong dosage of medication, was completely preventable and was caused by distraction. That on average, when a nurse was dosing out the medication, when he or she was doing these dosing rounds, they found that they were interrupted on average 10 times per dosing round. And what they found was that every time they were interrupted, they were making mistakes, not every time, but that was making them more likely to make mistakes. And sometimes these mistakes would have lethal consequences. So why do I tell you this story? I know very few of you are nurses dosing out medication. I tell you this story because we ourselves don't realize when we're getting distracted. And just like these nurses who didn't realize the devastating consequences of their mistakes until the next day or much later, when somebody, you know, was having health condition because of a mistake they had made, many of us don't realize how much better our performance could be if we worked without distraction. So there's a happy ending to this story. You see, these nurses, they came up with a solution that reduced prescription mistakes by 88%. They almost eliminated this problem completely, an 88% reduction in prescription mistakes. And the solution was not some fancy retraining program. It wasn't some multi-million dollar technology. The solution, get this, was plastic vests. Vests that these nurses wore that told their colleagues that when they were doing their drug round, that the drug round was in progress, so do not disturb. Okay, again, I know very few of you are nurses, but I'm telling you this because we can do something similar in our workplace. Every copy of my book, Indistractable, comes with a cutout, a cardstock cutout that you pull out of the book, you fold into thirds, you put it on your computer monitor for an hour or two a day when you need to work without distraction, and you tell your colleagues, hey, this is the time I need to focus. I know many of you are saying, yeah, but that's when I put headphones on. No, you don't understand. When you put on headphones, people think you're watching YouTube videos, okay? They think you're listening to a podcast. So that's something you do in addition if you want to, but having a very clear message that says explicitly, I am indistractable right now, please do not disturb unless it's really important, is how we can start spreading this culture of making sure it's okay to have an hour of time when I work with that distraction. Some of you are saying, okay, that's great, but I don't work in an office. I work from home. And my biggest distraction isn't my boss, it's my kids. Hey, I got a solution for you. This is a picture of my wife, and she is wearing what we affectionately call in my household, the concentration crown. The concentration crown is what we described to our child when she was only 6 years old. My daughter was 6 years old. We bought this crown on Amazon. I think it cost us $5. And we told her, hey, when you see mommy wearing the concentration crown, that means she can't be interrupted. And she will be with you within 30 minutes. Okay, we promise we will be with you within 30 minutes. So go do something else for that time, unless you're bleeding. The rule of my household, you don't interrupt mommy and daddy if they're wearing the concentration crown, unless you're bleeding. And guess what? At only 6 years old, my daughter understood it. She follows it. Today she's 14 years old and we still use something like the concentration crown. And not only is this very good with children, it's incredibly effective with husbands as well, because I used to interrupt my wife because I would see her at the computer. I didn't know that she needed her time to work with that distraction. So get yourself a concentration crown. It doesn't have to be this one. You can use any silly hat or something that essentially interrupts the interruption. That's what you're doing here. Because again, your family members, they don't know if you're doing something really important that you really need to concentrate, or whether you're just doing something that would allow you to be interrupted. What if you're working remotely with colleagues? Well, there's all kinds of free tools. For example, isbusy.app is this wonderful site you can check so that you have this green light, red light, yellow light that signifies, hey, am I available for interruption or am I working without distraction? And by simply typing in this URL / the colleague's name, it's this free tool that will tell you if your colleague is available to be interrupted. What about our phones? You know, our phone can be a huge source of distraction. Well, it turns out that today, everyone's phone comes pre-installed with these wonderful tools that help us fight distraction. You know, many people will say, well, I can't work without distraction because you see, what if there's an emergency? What if somebody really needs me? Okay, well, first of all, if your house is on fire, they're not going to email you, right? They're going to call, they're going to text, they're going to get to you in a way that is a medium that you would be more likely to reply when something is urgent. But then does that mean I need to have my phone on at all times in case I'm interrupted? No, what you can do is to use this beautiful setting. It's on every Apple device, it's on every Android device called Do Not Disturb While Driving. With one button, when this feature is engaged and someone calls you, they will receive an automatic reply that says, I can't talk right now, but if this is urgent, text me with the word urgent and the message will come through. So if it is, oh my God, it's such an emergency, they can't wait. They text the word urgent, the message will come through. I've been using this feature for years now. Nobody ever has said it's urgent, right? They can wait a few minutes and I'll get back to them after my time-boxed work time is up. What about your desktop? How many of us have desktops that look like this? This is what my desktop used to look like. And we know that all this visual clutter decreases our performance, right? All of these external triggers take up mindshare. So here's what you do. You take all those files that are on your desktop. You clear them away. You put them into a folder called everything. And when you need something, you simply search for it. The search tool functionality on our computers are so good today, you don't need all those files everywhere. And in fact, they've been proven to decrease and degrade your cognitive performance. Our phones, how many of us have pings and dings constantly throughout the day? This is simple stuff, right? Did you know that two-thirds of people with a smartphone never adjust their notification settings? That's ludicrous. Can we really say that technology is addicting us and the big bad tech companies are hijacking our brains when we haven't taken 5 minutes to turn off those notification settings that don't serve us? So the idea here is that we can hack back these external triggers. We know that these tech companies are trying to hack our attention. That's their job. They will never stop, but we're not powerless. We can hack back by asking ourselves this fundamental question. Is this trigger serving me or am I serving it? If that trigger is telling you, hey, it's time for the meeting, something you planned, it's time to exercise per your schedule, well, it's serving you. It's leading you towards traction. Great, keep it. But if it's some silly ping, ding, or ring that's taking you away from what you plan to do, like for example, when I was with my daughter, somebody I love very much, and now I was checking my phone because of some silly ding or ring, well, now I was serving it. So make sure you adjust those notification settings. And finally, leave those distracting devices outside of meetings, whether it's with our family. What we do in my family is we declare no phone zone. So one no phone zone is the dining room table, right? If we're going to be together, we want to be together physically as well as mentally, as opposed to everyone being on their devices. Let's carry that over into the boardroom. If we're going to have a meeting, let's not have a zombie meeting where people are there, their bodies are there, but there's no brains in the room because the brains are somewhere in cyberspace. So if we're going to have a meeting in the real world, whether it's a lunch meeting, whether it's a meeting around a conference table, let's make sure we declare those no phone zones so we can be fully present with each other. Finally, the last step to becoming indistractable is to prevent distraction with pacts. Now, these are what we call pre-commitment devices. And the first recorded case of someone using a pre-commitment device comes to us from the story of Ulysses in the Odyssey. In this ancient story, Ulysses has to sail his ship past the island of the Sirens. Now, the Sirens are these magical creatures that sing this song, that any sailor who hears the siren song crashes his ship onto the shore of the Sirens Island and dies. Now, Ulysses in the story knows this is going to happen. And so he wants to take precautions to make sure he doesn't get distracted. So what does he do? He tells the members of his crew to put beeswax in their ears so they can't hear the siren song. And he instructs them to bind him to the mast of the ship. And he tells them, no matter what I do, no matter what I say, don't let me go. And you know what? The plan works. He is able to sail his ship right past the island of the Sirens and return his ship and his crew safely home. Now, why do I tell you this story? Of course, it's a metaphor because you are Ulysses in the story. There's lots of distracting stuff out there on the internet. And of course, that could be you there dead on the shore of the Sirens Island. So we can actually make these very same Ulysses pacts in our own lives today. We can prevent getting distracted by making a pre-commitment. One of the ways we can do this is by using technology to block out distracting technology. So one app I use almost every single day, my daughter has been using it as well for years. It's so simple and beautiful. It's called Forest. Forest is this wonderful app that you open up, you type in how much time you want to do focused work for. Let's say it's 30 minutes, an hour, however much time you want to work at that distraction. You hit a button that says plant, and then you will be given this cute little tree on your screen. And if you pick up your phone and you do anything with it, that little cute virtual tree gets chopped down. And you don't want to be a virtual tree murderer. So it's just enough of a reminder to tell you, oh, I made that promise. I made that pre-commitment to get back to work on what I said I was going to do with my time and attention, as opposed to something frivolous on my phone. Same thing on your desktop. You can use an app like Cold Turkey during certain times of the day so that If all else fails, and for some reason you find yourself on BuzzFeed or Amazon or 4chan or whatever the site of choice that you often use when you're getting bored or stressed or anxious, and you reflexively turn to one of these sites, a product like Cold Turkey will block those sites during certain times of the day that you predetermine. Another thing you can do is to get a focus friend. So if you're working back at the office, if you can find a colleague to say, hey, look, it would really help me. What do you think about working together and doing some focused work time together? We'll both get a cup of coffee. We'll be side by side and we'll do our work together. This has been shown to greatly increase your chance of staying focused. But what if you say, hey, I'm not working in the office. I'm working from home. I got you. So what you need to do is to go over to focusmate.com, and a full disclosure, I am an investor in the company because I loved it so much. I found myself using it all the time. And so I decided to invest in the company. With a product like Focusmate, you are matched during a time slot with another person who has the same goal of being indistractable. And for that time of just 45 minutes, you sign in, you say, hello, what are you working on? What are you working on? You see each other over video. This was a medical school student in the Czech Republic. I was preparing for this presentation. He was studying anatomy. I said, go. And we each worked independently. It sounds frivolous. It sounds silly. But let me tell you, it's incredible how making that pact with another person to work without distraction is incredibly powerful, simple technique to work in a more focused fashion. The idea here, there's many other techniques, but the idea here is to reduce distraction with PACs by using this very same technology to block out distraction. But let me give you a word of warning. Be careful. There's two things I want to warn you about. Number one, we want to make sure that this is the thing you do last. Okay. Some people, they hear about these tech solutions and they jump immediately to that. But I will tell you, if you immediately jump to the PACs, to the tech solutions that some of them that we discussed earlier, but you haven't done the other three steps, you will fail. Okay, because again, most distraction begins from within. So it needs to start with understanding how you will deal with those internal triggers when you feel those uncomfortable emotional states. Do you have time on your calendar? Have you made time for traction in your day? Have you hacked back the external triggers? Then as the last step, you want to use these pre-commitment devices. And then the other word of warning is that we know that some people, these techniques don't work for. They don't work for the kind of person who, when they fail, has a lot of trouble getting back on the horse, okay? And what type of person is that kind of person? What is the kind of person who, when they fail, can't get back on? It turns out that studies find that the kind of person who doesn't offer themselves self-compassion, that giving yourself self-compassion has been shown to be one of these techniques that people who offer themselves self-compassion are much more likely to reach their long-term goals. Well, how do we cultivate self-compassion? The secret to cultivating self-compassion is to talk to yourself the way you would talk to a good friend, okay? So if I told you, for example, what had happened with my daughter, that I was embarrassed with myself about how I had treated her, that I got distracted when I was planning to be with someone I love very much, would you tell me that I'm a horrible human being, that I'm a terrible father? Not if you were my good friend, you wouldn't say those things. But I used to tell myself those very things all the time. And it wasn't true, and it wasn't helpful. And here's what else isn't true and isn't helpful. This idea that there's nothing we can do about these distractions, that technology is somehow hijacking our brains and addicting everyone, that is not true. We can master the internal triggers. We can make time for traction. We can hack back the external triggers, and we can prevent distraction with PACs. So there's a lot more in my book that we didn't get to cover today. For example, there's a whole section on how to raise indistractable kids, how to be an indistractable lover, and how to build an indistractable workplace. Super important topics. I hope you'll check out the book and dig in more. Also happy to take your questions. But the key message I want to leave with you today is that we can do this. We can all become indistractable. We can get the best out of these tools without letting them get the best of us. Thank you so much. And before I take questions, there's one quick favor I'd love to ask, which is I would love to know what you thought of the presentation. So if you have just a quick second, if you have your phone handy, you can just point it at that QR code and it'll take you to this URL. If you're in front of your computer, you can just type in opinion2.us. Notice it's not .com, it's opinion2.us. There you'll find a very short survey. It's only 5 questions. And as the little reward for taking the survey for me, it will only take you 30 seconds. You can have all the slides you just saw. You'll be given a link to my SlideShare page where you can have all those slides. Feel free to share them with your colleagues, your friends, your family, anybody that might find it useful. And of course, if you have any questions that I didn't get to answer today, please do check out my website, nearandfar.com. I publish a blog weekly, so feel free to check that out. And my email, in case you want to reach out personally, is just my first name, near@nearandfar.com. And with that, I'd love to take some questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Nir. I know I am. I'm sure we're all feeling way more prepared to approach our work with so much more focus now. And I have to say, the visual of your wife's concentration crown really resonated with me. I have a daughter, so I was like, when can I start introducing that?
Did you buy it or you added it to cart already on Amazon?
Yeah, to cart. There are so many cool tools out there to help us hack back on distractions. And obviously that's a big reason why we have you here today with Clockwise. And so I'm hoping we can dig in more with that. So right now what we're doing is shifting over into Q&A. So if you have any questions, go ahead and find that Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom window and pop your question in. I will get us started with a question that you just, a topic that you just very briefly brought up, but is super important. And I know you talk about it in your book, an indistractable workplace. So this is something we think a lot about at Clockwise. So I'm curious, from your perspective, what are some of the most important factors or elements at a high level view of an indistractable workplace?
Yeah. So there's a whole section in the book about this topic because, you know, to be honest, you can be indistractable. You can use all the techniques we just described. But if your boss insists on calling you at 9 p.m. every night when you're putting your kids to bed and doesn't respect your time and attention, or what I hear a lot is now that people are getting back into the office, that they're finding, actually, my boss is really distracting because she taps me on the shoulder every 5 minutes and wants to gossip or wants to ask about how a project is coming along when all I need to do is actually do the work. So what do you do if that's the case? Well, it turns out that distraction in the workplace is a symptom of cultural dysfunction. Okay, I'll say that again. Distraction in the workplace is a symptom of cultural dysfunction. That, the leading hypothesis is that, distraction is caused by these technologies. And so technology is the problem. And so I decided to explore that hypothesis. And I went to a company that I oftentimes hear is a source of distraction. So when we do surveys, the number one source of distracting technology in the workplace is email. Number one is email. Number two is Slack or some other group messaging service. So I actually went to Slack headquarters and I wanted to see, bang on their door and complain to them, you're making everybody distracted. But when I got there, what I was amazed to find is that that very company was not struggling with the problem of distraction, right? And I was curious why, because you would think about it, if the source of the problem is the technology, right, then no one should be more distracted than Slack because they use it more than anybody. But that's not what I found at all. That in fact, there's a few reasons why. And I do a case study on Slack in the book, and I do a case study on a few other companies. And so what I found was that there's three traits of an indistractable workplace. The number one trait is that people have psychological safety. Psychological safety is the ability to air problems, to air grievances without fear of retribution. Because here's the thing, if you can't talk about this problem of distraction at work, that is the canary in the coal mine. That is the symptom of a larger cultural dysfunction. And I promise you, if you fear getting fired by saying, hey, do you think I can have an hour a day without interruption? Would that be okay? This is really grating on my performance. Or do you think I can have a weekend without constantly feeling like I have to be connected? If you can't talk about that, that's the problem. You don't have the psychological safety to talk about this problem in the first place. And I guarantee you, you probably have all kinds of other skeletons in the closet that you're not able to talk about. So the first trait of an indistractable company is that people have the psychological safety to talk about these issues in the first place. The second trait is that people have a forum to talk about these problems. So at Slack, it's so interesting. They have a channel, a Slack channel in company headquarters that the employees use called Beef Tweets. And Beef Tweets is meant to be a place where people can air their grievances, like what's going wrong in the company, what's wrong about the product, what can they change in the culture. And it's fascinating that the management at the company uses emoji to respond. So it may not be that they fix every problem, but every employee feels heard. So sometimes they'll use the eye emojis to say, we saw that, or a checkmark emoji to show, hey, we took care of that. The point is, again, not to necessarily fix every complaint, it's to make sure people feel like there is a forum to talk about these concerns. And the third trait of an indistractable company is that leadership exemplifies what it means to be indistractable, okay? And I do many of these workshops, these day-long sessions where I come in and I'm hired for an expensive fee to teach a company how to be indistractable. And I show up and they have all the employees in a room. And guess who is most likely to be in the room checking their device or checking email while I'm giving my presentation? It's not the millennials, right? It's not the kids that we think, oh, they're all on TikTok all the time. No, no, no. You know who it is? It's the big boss, the important boss who's way too busy to pay attention and look how important I am. I'm answering email at all hours of the day. Well, here's what happens. When you are in a setting like that and you have people who report to you, culture flows downhill like water. Culture flows downhill. So people look to management for what the expectations of connectedness are. So if the boss is always connected, well, that sets a tone for how everyone else should work. So being indistractable, building an indistractable workplace requires management to exemplify what it means to be indistractable. So in Slack headquarters, one of the things I was shocked to see was that in the company canteen, okay, where everybody gets together for lunches every single day, there is a huge sign, and there's a picture of it in my book, in pink, like bright pink, it says, work hard and go home, right? That's not something you would expect for a hard-charging Silicon Valley company like Slack, but that is part of their company ethos. From the CEO on down, they understand that to do your best work, you have to be able to work without distraction.
I love that. And so we have so many folks, I oftentimes think of the folks that use Clockwise as change makers, like even if they are not in management, they have decided that focus time is important to them and they're going to use our product and advocate for that change. And I know a lot of the folks that we have today are individual contributors or not in senior management. So I'm just curious, you gave a few examples of like literally putting on a vest and different things we can do, but I'm just curious if you have any talking points or advice for someone to explain how valuable it is for them to their manager and to advocate for themselves.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So this is called managing up. And when it comes to time management, there's a few techniques we can use. One of my favorites is to do what's called a schedule sync, which is why, I mean, this is hand in glove with what Clockwise does and why I'm such a big advocate for time boxing, is that when you make a calendar for yourself, you have an artifact. You have something that you can share with other people. And one of the things that people don't realize that when they have somebody over them, right, when they have a manager, is that managers spend a good chunk of their day wondering what their employees are doing, right? Like even the best of them, they don't want to micromanage you. They don't want to bother you and check up on you, but they would really like to know what your priorities are right now, how you're spending your time. And so what you can do is this schedule sync. So I advise folks to do this about once a week. Sit down with your boss, okay? And this is much more effective, by the way, than telling them and preaching to them and convincing them. Don't tell, but show them how you do this in your own life. You show them, hey, boss, can we sit down? I just need 15 minutes of your time, okay? And you sit down with them and you can print this out or you can show it on your screen. Show them your calendar. Show them your time box schedule. Here's how I'm going to spend my 9 to 5 for this week, okay? You see, I've got time for this project. I have time for the meeting you asked me to go to. Here's where I'm checking email. And you literally show them your time box calendar for when you are working, right? When you're expected to be productive. Then you show them this other piece of paper, all right? This other list of things that you couldn't fit into that schedule. Things they asked you to do that you couldn't fit into the schedule. And you ask them to do their number one part of a manager's job is to help you prioritize. And you say, hey, here's these things that I couldn't figure out where to put in my schedule. Can you help me reprioritize? And almost every time they're going to say, you know, that meeting, you really don't need to be on that meeting. But you know, this thing that you put here, I think that's much more important. I'd really like you to focus on that. And so what this does for you is a few things. One, it gives your manager exposure into how the heck you're spending your time. They would kiss the ground you walk on to know exactly what you're working on. Two, it helps you align around what your real priorities are. And three, it gives them notice for time that you expect to be indistractable, time that you don't want to be interrupted. Because if, did I lose you there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Sorry. Because when you share with them, hey, here's when I'm checking email, here's when I'm doing this, here's where I'm doing that, they as well are synchronized with your calendar to know when it's time for when you are able to be interrupted and when you expect not to be interrupted. So that's schedule sync is a game changer. By the way, I also do this with my wife. For years, we would argue about household responsibilities. And she would you know, kind of chastise me for saying, look, you know, don't you see the garbage needs to be taken out? Don't you see our daughter needs to be fed? Like, why aren't you doing these things? And of course, my excuse to her was, honey, if you need me to do something, just tell me what to do. I'll do it. And of course, I didn't realize that I was giving her yet another job. Now I'm asking her to be my babysitter, right? So we don't do that anymore. We don't have that fight anymore. Why? Because once a week, we sit down together and we do a schedule sync. Every Sunday evening, I take out my time box calendar. She takes out her time box calendar. And we schedule the week ahead. And we say, okay, you need to pick up our daughter then. You're making dinner then. Trash will be taken out then. It's in the calendar. And it's made our marriage so much better. We've been married for over 20 years now. It is one of the secrets to our happiness.
So much gold. Work and life coming together. I love it. I'm hoping we can tackle two more questions. From Melissa. She says she loves the framing of plan your day or someone else will. I do as well. How do you recommend balancing having control over your time while also still allowing for flexibility when needed?
Yeah, great question. So there are times when you need to be on call. Okay. Now, every job has some degree, some balance between what we call reactive work and reflective work. Reactive work is the kind of work that reacting to emails, reacting to notification, being I think with this question, what Melissa's asking, being ready to be flexible and when someone needs you. That's reactive work. Everybody's job has some degree of reactive work. Everybody's job also has some degree of reflective work. Time when you work without distraction. And by the way, this is where all the thinking, the strategizing, the planning happens. And if you don't have some time in your day for reflective work, I guarantee you, you're running real fast in the wrong direction. So what I'm advocating for is not, you know, depending on your job, some people's job is to be available all day long. Like if you're a manager, many times your entire day is meant to be on call, right? And that's fine, plan for it. But plan as well 30 minutes, 45 minutes, sometime in your day to sit and think for yourself, to strategize, to plan. That's got to be a portion for other jobs. For example, if you're a software engineer, you're pretty much entire day in reflective work with just a little bit of reactive work. So the idea is you can actually plan ahead for that. You can say, hey, I'm on call Tuesdays and Thursdays from noon to six. That's my time when my office is open. I'm ready, whatever you need, come in, ask questions, but save your questions. Don't come on those times when that time is not apportioned for. And having a quick discussion with your team and saying, here's my office hours is something that people appreciate because then they don't feel bad about interrupting. Hey, that's the time when this is apportioned for.
Very cool. It kind of makes me think, I wonder if it's almost an extension of no meeting days that are pretty common. So like days where you reduce the number of distractions, but you also have a different mindset on those days.
Sure. Those are fine. So there's goods and bads. So if you plan these no meeting days, that's fine. I mean, that's wonderful, but I wouldn't skip the other stuff. So sometimes what we see happening is that companies say, well, I heard it's a really good thing to have a no meeting day or no email Fridays or, you know, whatever, no Slack Wednesdays. Okay. But unless you have those other prerequisites of a place where people can talk about these problems and the psychological freedom to do so and management team that exemplifies what it means to be indistractable, you may have the right solution for the wrong problem. So if this is generated organically, hey, if we say, hey, you know what, we're going to read this book for the company book club. We've generated a bunch of ideas to solve this problem for us specifically. And you know what? One of the solutions that specifically addresses our problem is no meeting Fridays. Great. But if you come in and say, hey, I got it. I know how we're all going to be indistractable. No meeting Fridays. It's not going to work. It has to be generated organically.
Yeah, totally agree. The thoughtfulness behind it and making sure it actually solves the problem. Got a question from Katie. So she says, I'm excited to employ the pain management strategies to avoid the temptation of distraction. How long will it take for these to become regular practice?
Immediate and forever. So how long does it take for these to be useful? Literally immediately. So if you next time, think for yourself real quick, what's a distraction you wish you could overcome? And you could immediately, the next time you have that temptation, implement the 10-minute rule. right? That's something anybody can do right away. I'm going to give myself 10 minutes before I give into that distraction. Of course, the beauty of that technique is that the 10 minutes becomes 11 minutes, becomes 15 minutes, becomes 20 minutes, and you're proving to yourself, actually, wait a minute, I do have control. I am able to delay gratification a bit. I don't have to be so impulsive. So you're building that muscle so that you can implement immediately. When I say forever, this will always be a challenge, right? You never stop struggling with this. I still struggle with this. And you know what? Sometimes I still get distracted, but here's the difference. A distractible person keeps getting distracted by the same things again and again. Paulo Coelho had a wonderful quote. He said, a mistake repeated more than once is a decision. I'll say it again. A mistake repeated more than once is a decision. A distractible person is making a decision to be distractible because they keep getting distracted. Okay, we got it. Facebook, they're super bad. They're distracting you. How many times can we get distracted by the same things before we say enough? I'm going to do something about it. So an indistractable person says, okay, I see what you did there, distraction. I'm not going to let that happen again because every distraction only has three causes: an internal trigger, an external trigger, or a planning problem. So an indistractable person takes steps today to prevent getting distracted tomorrow.
Awesome. This has been so great. I think we've gotten through all of our questions. Thank you so much, Nir.
My pleasure.
So many thoughts and feelings. I need to like go write all of these takeaways down. And thank you for also opening up the access to your slides. We will share the recording out of this talk as well. So if folks want to share it with their colleagues, their manager, to kind of advocate for what is super important in being indistractable in our work. Anything else you would like to add, Nir?
No, thank you so much. Of course, feel free to reach out if there's any questions I didn't address that you want answered. Here, I'll type in my website here again in the chat, nirfar.com. There's also, by the way, a free workbook. Here, I'll type this in as well, this URL. If you go to indistractable.com, there's a free 80-page workbook. We couldn't fit in the final edition of the book. It got too long, but that's complimentary if you go to indistractable.com as well.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. Yeah, I think
I don't know if that appears in the chat. Okay.
Yep. I think. Oh, you sent it to hosts and panelists. So let's get that copied over.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Here. Well, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, everyone. Go ahead and head to the website, get that awesome workbook, and thanks for joining.
Thank you. Take care.